Shauna Bostock, an Indigenous academic, was researching her family history when she discovered something that rocked her world. Her ancestors had been slave traders. What a thing for anyone to discover, but especially an Indigenous person. One of the white fellas in her family tree was a slaver. What do you do about that? Do you condemn those to whom you owe your very existence? And if we judge those of the past, what will of our grandchildren think about us? This is the dilemma we face as we read the book of Joshua. For the next little while, we're going back to Joshua, and I want to encourage you to read along. Why Joshua? It's the next part of the story we've been following these past few years. The Hebrew slaves have arrived in the promised land. They've arrived. Now what? It's where we are as a church. We've been on a long journey turning a dream of a community-engaged church into a reality. Like in the book of Exodus, not everyone wanted to come along. But now that we're here, now what? Are we like the dog chasing the bicycle? Usually we don't catch it. But now we've caught one. Now what? That's why we've been engaging in this vision and mission process. We're really asking, now what? Joshua and his crew have been there. What did they learn? That's why we're looking at Joshua. But here's the thing. Joshua is perhaps the most difficult, most horrible book in the Old Testament. It's got genocide and colonialization. How can we learn from that? It's a dangerous book, but we say it's the word of the Lord. What is perhaps just as important then is not what Joshua got right, but what they got wrong. Because here's the thing. The story of coming into the promised land is a failed experiment. Yes, they took the land. Yes, they established a nation. The promises of God were fulfilled, but were they a light to all nations, blessed to be a blessing, a holy people? Their exile some 700 years later says it didn't quite work. Joshua's name means the Lord saves. At a human level, the Lord saved these slaves and gave them a new land. That's something to celebrate. But they didn't become the salvation for the world that God intended. In fact, they grew fat, complacent, corrupt, unconcerned for the vulnerable or God, and they were taken into exile. What have we said before? Affluence builds arrogance. And that's why we call this the Old Testament. Apologies to our Jewish friends. Here are all the ways we humans, guided by God, tried to fix things, tried to save ourselves, but it just didn't work. So how do we read Joshua? When we were kids, we heard all the exciting adventures of Joshua fighting the Battle of Jericho, and we didn't blink. These were the good guys fighting the bad guys, and the Indians lived again tomorrow. But as I've grown, I've realized that even the bad guys were created in God's image. The idea of annihilating a people, men, women, and children, is horrific. And that this command is on the lips of God, well, it's wow. Is this the God that we know in Christ? Is this a God that we can worship? Meredith Lakes, writer of this fabulous book, writes that reading the Bible is like sitting down with both a wise old friend and a stranger from another place. A few things to understand then as we read this book that is a wise old friend but also is very strange. We're going into a foreign time and place. Don't be quick to judge. Like Shauna Bostock's story, our society has been confronted with the strangeness of our past. We've wanted to pull down statues of our heroes because we've found uncomfortable truths about them. But reading history with a polar mindset, black and white, heroes and villains, is a dangerous thing to do. And in the end, all we'll find is villains and we'll end up condemning ourselves. Because as I've said so many times, the difference between good and evil runs through every human heart. Jesus told us, judge not and you will not be judged. It's much better to read history for understanding than grandstanding. In Joshua's day, there were no police, no army, no universal laws. Even the Ten Commandments, which we assume were universal, the Hebrews only applied to themselves, their own tribe. Do not kill a fellow Hebrew. Do not steal from a Hebrew. Everyone else was fair game, and that's how everyone else thought at the time. This was not civilization as we would name it. If our society broke down to what we see in these dystopian movies, we would very quickly descend to the rule of muscle that we find in the book of Joshua. I mean, even still today, don't we cheer when Katniss fights Pan Am? It's still in us. Organizing yourself in connected communities is how you survive. And when we think about war, what's life like in Ukraine at the moment? Isn't this what we've done to our service personnel in the past? We've judged them from the safety of our lounge room. We do this a lot as humans. So read Joshua for understanding, not grandstanding. Secondly, we forget that we only find the Old Testament abhorrent because of the New. It was very interesting hearing the story of our person who's in the Middle East at the moment and her describing what life is like over there, where you've got towns based on ethnicity, where this ethnicity lived there, this ethnicity lived there, and that defined what kind of jobs you could do, and there was a real class structure going on. And if some of these people got on a bus with these people, they would say, "Oh, something smells." In cultures where the New Testament hasn't taken hold, the stories of Joshua aren't so strange. It really does show how Jesus' saving work has transformed our society, slowly but astonishingly. So read Joshua knowing Jesus hasn't come yet. And that's the third thing. God's revelation is unfolding. God's revelation to us has been slow enough for us to keep up. Well, maybe. It's like learning anything. We don't get it all on day one. And we've still got more to unpack from the Jesus story. God does not change, but boy, do we need to. We're not ready to know everything about God. I mean, everything, just the hem of God's robe almost destroyed Isaiah. When we read the Old Testament, God is revealing more and more of himself until Christ. And that's the reading that we heard today. In the past, God spoke to our ancestors through the prophets at many times and in various ways. But in these last days, he has spoken to us face to face by his Son, whom he anointed heir of all things and through whom he made the universe. The Son is the radiance of God's glory, the exact representation of his being. What we see in the Old Testament is like looking through glass darkly. But we see constant glimpses of God's radiance. The story of Rahab in Joshua 2, God's saving grace to an unworthy foreigner, is a glimpse of the grace revealed in Christ. God's true nature is emerging. And so we have to read God's command to destroy everyone in this context of the unfolding revelation. For sure, God demands justice, and then he can show grace. Grace without justice doesn't make sense. But Paul, why didn't God just send Jesus in Genesis 4? I mean, straight after the fall, fix everything right away. We just weren't ready. But there is a cosmic logic to it as well. It wouldn't have worked. After we stuff things up, for us to be ready to accept grace, God had to give us every opportunity to save ourselves. Until humanity had been given every opportunity to save ourselves, psychologically, we would not have been ready to accept that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And we certainly wouldn't have been ready to accept that all are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. Well, hang on, Paul. Hang on, God. How do you know that? We could have fixed this problem. If you'd just gotten rid of all the bad people, washed them away in some global catastrophe, and given a righteous family a chance to rebuild the world, like that would have fixed things. We don't need Jesus. Or if you'd chosen a specific race of people and given them insight into your ways, given them a land flowing with milk and honey in which to become a beacon to the world, that would have worked, and we still wouldn't have needed Jesus. Or if he'd given us 10 simple rules, a list of 10 universal truths we all had to follow, you know, don't murder, don't steal, all the ones that are obvious. If you'd just told us that and then we failed, I mean, how easy would 10 rules like that have been? If we'd failed to do that, then you would have been justified to have said, all have sinned. But until that happens, you can't condemn us. Or if you'd sent us prophets filled with the Spirit of God to teach us your truths, or given us priests and a religious system of sacrifice and ritual, or if you'd given us kings whose hearts were after your very own, or wise philosophers who would give us earthly wisdom to enable us to live, or divinely inspired musicians who would give us songs and psalms of praise and devotion, laments and adoration, with their words, that would have been enough. We would have been okay. Or God, we needed a chance to create a country with only holy people, a holy land with a holy temple, where we cleansed out all the crap from the beginning. Anyone and anything that wasn't of you, we totally annihilated, so that what we built would be heaven on earth. Until you give us that opportunity, you can't condemn us. Isn't that what the Old Testament is? God giving us every opportunity to put in place our terrible and terrific, our dark and horrific plans to save ourselves and watch it all fail. To unequivocally know, beyond a shadow of a doubt, that I can't save myself. When we read Joshua, we must remember that genocide didn't work. Purity, exclusion, extreme religiosity didn't work. We keep thinking it will. The Nazis, how were they trying to save the world? A pure master race. No, it's still happening today when we want to cancel anyone because they don't agree with what we think. This is a psychological journey we all must go on. I've had people sit in church, hear a powerful message of God's grace and reject it because, and they've said this to me, Paul, that's just too easy. I've just got to accept God's love. It's got to be harder than that. I have to earn it for it to be worth anything. It's like your sermon is suggesting I can't earn it. I mean, how dare you say that? Just accept Jesus and follow him? No way. I'm going to go out there and I'm going to find a way to save myself. The irony is, the thing we think is too easy, accepting grace, is the hardest thing for us humans to do because we have to put our egos aside. To people who've had their ego put aside by the world, the oppressor, the religious right, it is easy to do. They already know their sinners. They're the people that Jesus met and he went to them, and no one else thought, you shouldn't go to those, but these guys know, they're ready. To the other people he met, the Pharisees who were sure of their own righteousness, this is incredibly difficult. Joshua means the Lord saves. When God's son came, he was given the name Jesus, which is the Greek version of the Hebrew Joshua. Jesus also means the Lord saves. Jesus is Joshua 2.0. Jesus is the one who does save the world. Joshua is our human attempt. Jesus is God making good, not by sacrificing others, but by sacrificing himself. That's the divine way. Wow. That's a much harder way to bring peace, reconciliation, redemption, and restoration to our world. Make others pay or be willing to pay the price ourselves? Are we willing to not just follow Jesus, but his way for our world? I said this is a psychological journey we all have to make. Have you made that journey yet? Have you put your ego aside? And is today the day to do that? I used to think I don't want to embarrass people by saying, come to the front, receive Christ. But if we have to put our ego aside to be saved, what's coming to the front? I'm going to pray with people now. And in our service, we actually gave people a chance to come up the front and to pray this prayer. Is it time for you to lay your ego aside? Let's pray. Lord God, as we go back and read the book of Joshua, we're challenged by what we find horrible now. And we suddenly realize we find it horrible because we know how much you love us. We know how much you have love for us. And we know how much your ways are beyond these ways. So as we read Joshua, may we remember, oh, you, Lord, you, Lord, you, Lord. Let's read for understanding. But let's do more than that. Let's read to know the same Lord that Joshua knew. Let's be willing to not continue the mistake of thinking, I can save myself. We can do it. If we just get rid of those people, if we just clean this up, if we just do that, no. If we just bow our knees, surrender our egos to you, Lord. So today we want to say, Lord, I'm sorry for how I've lived. I'm sorry for the ego I've been. May I put my knees down for you. May I make you Lord of my life. May I follow you and fill me, Lord, with your spirit. Fill me, Lord, with your spirit to then seek to follow in your way, to bring this redemption and restoration to our world and to the relationships around me. In Christ's name, amen.